Thank you everyone, thank you ma'am for this kind introduction of me. And this is indeed a very emotional moment for me to coming back at Modern Law College where I have served for 8 years, and this was my first employment, and I will cherish the memories whichever I have gathered here as assistant professor, and it has enriched me, it has given me a new perspective to look at academic career, and that's why I'm very much thankful to the management and the organizers and my colleagues, previous colleagues. And again, this is another burden and opportunity to present in front of my teacher, Payal ma'am. So she had been my teacher at Department of Law. So we have learned a great deal from her. So I'm taking this kind of ahead. I will take some courage for this presentation further. So just to start with the topic which I was given, and I will be deliberating with you on a very important topic from this particular National Education Policy 2020. We know that government has started this initiative way back. This policy hasn't come in a 1 year or 2 years. It has taken some, what I see or what I researched, it's more than 50 years of research they have taken, and then they have taken reference to the global practices and all. So the document is very important, because as of now you are learning law, as of now we are teaching, so it is going to impact us, but it is going to create an impact for the country coming 100 years we can expect. There have been many educational policies which India had adopted earlier also, and those policies have created a greater impact on our lives. So whatever we learn, like 10 plus 2 plus 3 plus 2, whatever these patterns we are seeing, these metrics we are seeing, these are all outcomes of these national education policies. So definitely this policy is going to be implemented for future generations, and that will create another impact. So the point of concern here is, this policy, when it came in the year 2020, there have been deliberations, discussions all over India. So earlier policies, like for example 1969 or other policies, we were not having, or we were not present either, or we don't know whether that kind of deliberations had been there. Obviously there had been, something might be there, but as of now we are witnessing this particular whole discussion. So the policies, multiple drafts, I think we have also worked on drafts, we have also suggested some suggestions to the NEP, and now it is being implemented, and still the people are open for discussions and suggestions. So that's what I think the purpose of this whole seminar series or workshop series which is being conducted at across national level. So we are expected to undergo this policy in detail, and we have to think of points which can be suggested, points which can be brought up, or points which can be considered by the policy makers. And fortunately these policy makers are still open for these suggestions. So let's start with the point which I have been allotted, and the type of topic I am talking about is multilingualism. Now multilingualism and NEP, it's a very important dimension. Whether multilingualism is new for India, let me know from you. So it's not new. So do we have this kind of a policy in our earlier curriculum, earlier education? Yes. So we used to talk first language, second language, and then we used to choose either Sanskrit or either German or either any other French, and many other languages were offered. So by that sense, this particular policy is not new. India being a country having a diverse population and diverse cultures, we do have many languages which are spoken in India, along with thousands of dialects we are having. And these dialects are also not similar. Like there are grammatical notions, like in Marathi, if you have a Marathi, there are 3 dialects. You call one dialect, Marathi dialect is another, Airani is another dialect. But if you talk in Airani, you will not understand. The grammatical and various connotations are different. But still we consider them as the dialects of Marathi, or Nangi, or either Malwani, and many other dialects are there. So along with this, particularly this NEP is focusing on multilingualism, and it is chosen, or it is very cautious about putting the words about multilingualism. So it's not talking about some vague terminologies. Why we need multilingualism? That's what the vision of NEP. So the whole presentation I have divide it into these three parts. First, we will be discussing briefly about what is the NEP vision about language policy. Secondly, I will be talking about language and education at the global level along with some case studies. And then lastly, we will discuss about challenges which we are going to face or which we need to address as a part of this particular implementation. So first, NEP 2020 on language. So these are the points or pointers where NEP talks about language throughout the policy. So the first part is multilingualism and power of language. Please pay attention to the terminologies or the head. These are the headings of the chapters. So please pay attention to that particular terminology as well. So it is mentioning about multilingualism and power of language. So the words are again chosen carefully. There is power entrusted or there is a power in language which is needed to underline that particular part. Equitable and inclusive education, learning format. So again, to become inclusive, to become equitable, again we have to think of language and language policies. Equity and inclusion in higher education, again there is reference to language. Bilingual education for future lawyers, more important point for us, all of us. I hope media, this gathering is, either is a mix of all branches. Yeah, but being a law academician, we have to discuss more, or we do have some points here to share. So that's why I kept that separate point, bilingual legal education. And then last is promotion of Indian languages, art and culture. So these parts are talking specifically about language. So I'm not going to detail of these all pointers, I just have referred it for the reference. So first it mentions that it is well understood young children learn and grasp non-trivial concepts of language more quickly, or concepts more quickly if they are being taught in their mother tongues. One of our teacher, English teacher, when we were learning at Irish Law College, so our English teacher was there, Usha Ganesh ma'am, some of you might be knowing her. So she used to tell us one thing, and that we did not know about it. So we went to her and I asked, like, ma'am, we are coming from a rural background or regional background and we do have some problems pertaining to English. So what to do? So she said one sentence, she said, how is your mother tongue? I said, it's good. Well, it's in literary sense, how you can speak your Marathi, whether do you have a good command over Marathi in grammatical sense? I said, yes, I do have. So then she said, don't worry about English. You keep enriching your mother tongue, automatically you will be enriched in English. And I didn't get that particular concept at that point of time. But then later on, I realized, yes, that's the worth. And now that is mentioned in NEP. So NEP says, if you are learning in your mother tongue till certain age of education, you will have leverage and you can learn any other concepts very quickly. That's what the vision of NEP talks about. And then it talks about 4.12, that extensive use of technology. I have skipped the earlier point. But it says extensive use of technology will be made for teaching learning of different languages and to popularize language learning. This is very important. Language is a mode of communication. It's a matter of communication. Like we have to, if you have to communicate, we have to be good at the language. And that's what is the vision of this NEP. Further, it is talking about three language formula. A very important and dynamic proposal which has been introduced by NEP, and it was discussed with a very much, what you say that, enthusiasm at national level. So what three languages we are talking about? Which three languages NEP is talking about? Yeah, can you tell me? Logically, what you say or what you suggest, one language that we have to learn is English. Being a global language, we have to learn English. And then what about other two languages? Hindi and? That's what precisely was objected by the South Indian states. That you cannot impose Hindi. What will be the third language? Mother tongue, fine. English, fine. Two languages are there. And that was the pattern we are having in the earlier education system, bilingual. Bilingual we were having, English we were learning, mother tongue also we were having. So there are Marathi schools, medium schools, there are English medium schools in Maharashtra particularly. But what about the third language? Which third language we have to learn? Yeah, but Marathi, regional language, You learned Marathi? You talked about English. What about third language? So the option earlier, people, those who had not gone through the policy, they had taken that objection, now you want to impose it. It is very clear about it. It says, three languages formula will continue to be implemented while keeping in the mind constitutional provisions, aspirations of people, regions and the union. So it is nowhere compelling you to take up the Hindi. So if you are in Maharashtra, you can take Kannada also as a language. And then it mentions that, however, there will be greater flexibility to three language formula and no language will be imposed on any state. So there is no imposition of language, but the very important part is that so long as at least two of three languages are native, this is what the vision is. It means English, one language, fine, global language, one mother tongue can be there, and one other native language you have to learn. So either you can choose any native language. So what are the native languages? It may be Hindi. If you want Hindi, you can choose Hindi. If you want Sanskrit, you can choose Sanskrit. If you want Tamil, you can choose Tamil. Whichever language you want, you should be able to choose it. But there should be three languages learned at school level. Now these pointers, like 4 point and 5 point, these are all put in the school education wala part. Okay, so then they are mentioning about higher education also there. If you see the last paragraph, there will be some mention about the higher education as well. Yes, so high quality bilingual textbooks, creation of textbooks, and then there are India's native languages which we are having, right? There are multiple languages in India, diverse country having classical languages like Sanskrit. 4.17 is talking about specifically Sanskrit. So there is no harm in learning Sanskrit as a language, because you all might be knowing that, not through WhatsApp forward but through the research, that Sanskrit is used in the coding, as a coding language, okay, in supercomputers or in many other ways Sanskrit has been used. So that may be a reason we can look at Sanskrit, but again we have again given option. That's not compulsion that you have to learn Sanskrit. And then it talks about a point, important point, which I felt is about ISL, Indian Sign Languages. So NEP specifically talks about this, and this talks about inclusion. When we are talking about inclusion in education, we need to have this particular mention of sign languages. So there should be a formulation and syllabus, or what I feel, in all other people, those who are not suffering from any disability, still they should be able to know what are the sign languages. If you want to work in an environment, if you want to work in a better world, equal world, equitable world, you need to know all these things. Otherwise, there will be a kind of, just clean up, if you are a colleague and if you want to employ a person who is visually impaired or a person who is having difficulty in speaking with a disability, will you be comfortable if you don't know sign languages? So no, obviously that will be the no. So that's what we should be talking about, that's what we should be mentioning about. The next part, 6.6 to 11, talks about equitable and inclusive education. So again, this mentions about languages. How we can achieve inclusivity? We can achieve it through language, multiple languages. If you are comfortable in your mother tongue and if you are getting education in your mother tongue, obviously dropout rates will be lesser. Equity and inclusion in higher education. So we all know that in India, school percentage or school intake or school admission rate is good as compared to other countries or low middle income countries. But dropout rate at higher education is more, which is the fact which we have to deal with. And why it happens? Because mostly in school education, we don't find any difficulty. Mostly they are available in mother tongues, mostly they are available in your neighborhood. But for higher education, you need to take some other efforts, and that's what people start getting drop out. So that is what concern about language also. If you are not comfortable with the language, because जैसे जैसे आप हायर एजुकेशन की तरफ बढ़ते हो, देर इज अ काइंड ऑफ अ बॉटलनेक क्रिएटेड इन टर्म्स ऑफ लैंग्वेज ऑल्सो, इन टर्म्स ऑफ फैसिलिटीज ऑल्सो, इन टर्म्स ऑफ अवेलेबल रिसोर्सेज ऑल्सो. एंड देन यू हैव टू बी, द कॉम्पिटिशन इज मोर. यू कैन गेट एडमिशन टू द स्कूल, बट गेटिंग एडमिशन टू द गुड हायर एजुकेशन इंस्टीट्यूट इज डिफिकल्ट. एंड देन इफ देर इज द लैंग्वेज इज पोजिंग एज अ बैरियर, obstacle, then again we have to think of it. Okay, for lawyers, bilingual formula for lawyers, future lawyers. So it was a point of concern raised when the measure was there under 20.4 that law should be available in regional language as well. So that was point which was vividly, I think, discussed and criticized by many law and legal academician practitioners also, because we want to achieve unity or unification of whole laws throughout the country. And we all know that being the lawyers, the more portion depends upon interpretation, and then the interpretation depends upon language and the language which is used. So we always say that the laws initially are drafted in English. So the intention of legislation which we want to draw, we have to draw it through the original language. And there might be this case and situation and scenario where translations can go wrong. And we have seen that. Translations have been problematic because of many other aspects. And so that is one challenge which we felt. And that's why we said that, okay, legal education of Kutch Mathuru, let it be the domain of Bar Council, let Bar Council decide on that. But still NEP had that point taken. And some states, like Maharashtra also, Maharashtra had already given permission to start or teach, or at least mode of writing or mode of instruction should be in Marathi. At least for this time, I think Savitribai Phule Pune University has allowed paper to be written in Marathi. But then again, problems of assessment and all, we'll be discussing that in challenges. But again, these are issues should be taken into consideration, because a remarkable number of lawyers, they practice in district courts, sessions courts or lower courts, subordinate judiciary, where regional language is used and there is no use of English. And from high court level, I think Marathi will start, but for regional levels, for at subordinate level, you have to use your regional language. And then what about people who are not good at Marathi? How to draft in Marathi? That's a difficult part. If you ask me or if you ask any teacher here sitting, we don't know about it. We can draft in English if you ask us, but in Marathi, because we don't know about terminologies. So had it been taught in the curriculum, had it been taught in our education days, it might have been a better situation. So you may be a good drafters, you may be a good lawyers at regional level if you talk about it. Okay, and then 22 talks about promotion of Indian languages. So HEI means higher education institutions should use mother tongue local language as a medium of instructions, or offer programs bilingually in order to increase access and to promote the strength and usage and vibrancy of Indian languages. So language is the organic part. We say language, like, it takes birth, it dies also. Okay, so many languages are on the brink of death because of non-use. It's the organic part. So language can die. If we know that is happening in India, many languages, you don't get translators, you don't get interpreters, you don't get people who can know it, people who can know the scripts and all. Like for example, Modi. Many legal documents are in Modi and we have very few people remaining who can know Modi or who can translate from Modi or we can use the script of Modi. So that is again another language. Okay, here again another point is that private higher education institutions should be encouraged. That is a challenge again we are going to discuss it again another. So global perspective, shifting on the international perspective, how and what is the exact status, and what about multilingualism, bilingualism, what is the status of scenario at the global level? So these are the numbers given by UNESCO. So about 6,700 languages recognized. Okay, having a separate script, having a separate way of speaking and grammar and everything. So there might be again multiplied by 3 to 4 dialects, like 6,700 other languages along with many dialects. Then 40% of world population cannot access education in language they speak or understand. Now these are all data of UNESCO, so we have to trust it. And then 6 years of mother tongue instruction is needed to reduce learning gaps for minority language speakers. So this is again a very important aspect. And then 40% of the estimated 6,700 languages spoken in 2016 were in danger of disappearing. So death of language is a very huge thing, like his extinction of animal. Okay, cheetah agar bhar se chala gaya, to we had that kind of a vacuum created and we had to bring them back from Africa. Though they are not having Indian origin, they're African cheetahs we are bringing in. But still, language is like that. If it is, it is extinct, then it will take thousands of years. A language is created in the thousands of years. It is not created in 1 or 2 years or 100 years. Okay. SDG also talks about language. Now the whole education system, whole NEP or your whole national legislations are moving around SDGs. So you have to align your education, you have to align your curriculum along with the SDG. So NEP has a special reference here for this goal 4, target 4.7, which talks about that learners acquire knowledge and skills needed to promote sustainable development, including among others, through education for sustainable development and sustainable lifestyle, human rights and promotion of all other things. So there is a scope for language. If multiple languages options are there, it will create enhanced accessibility. So access to education is important, and access to education can be achieved through availability of resources. And what about the world? How many languages a country speak? Or top most countries which are having multiple languages? Papua New Guinea is having 839 languages. You can just see the number of India. Officially we are having 454 languages. How many are scheduled? How many are scheduled languages? Scheduled, I think 8. Yes, 8, I think 8 schedule talks about language. So 22 are there. Again, I think 2, 3 and 4 have languages have been added. 24 number will be there. How many? Someone knows the current number. Okay, fine. So it means basically if a language is scheduled, you can attempt your UPSC paper in that particular scheduled language. So it doesn't mean, and the scheduled languages get a right to be established in the departments in state universities and various other universities if your language is scheduled. So like in Maharashtra, Marathi, Konkani, all these languages are scheduled, two languages. So some portion, again Konkani, Marathi are different, having their different dialects. So these languages, 454 languages are spoken in India. You can take an example of USA. We always see that USA might be the country which is having English, a prominence of English. So that's not true. So just below India, there's USA, which is having 522 languages. And as a case study, we are going to refer to US only. Okay, UNESCO talks about multilingual education, multilingual as approach to the education. Okay, so these four A's we have to think of, four A's of education. When we talk about language, so we need to understand and identify whether these four A's are present in any education system. And when we talk about accessibility, so availability, accessibility, adaptability, and acceptability. If you say that a school education should be accessible, so school education should have these four elements. Okay, available means, if I am comfortable in Marathi, I should be having access and availability of resources in Marathi. Okay, acceptability, adaptability about my condition, about my learning capacities, and that should be linked with the existing current situation or current syllabus, curricula, and everything. Okay, case study of US. For the reference, we have just taken how many languages are spoken in US, and out of it, how USA deals with their education policy when it comes to multilingualism. So they had an act of bilingual education in the year 1968 for English and Spanish speaking population, and then bilingual bicultural education act in the state of California in the year 1976. So what is the outcome of this? So we all know that in US there are multiple languages people are having, like Spanish is more impact, having more impact, and people are very stunned about it. If you come across to a person who is speaking Spanish, he will not speak in English, like French. If you go to France, they will not speak in English, though they know it. There are multiple aspects attached to it, like if you go to Tamil and if you ask in Hindi, these people will not revert. So like that. But apart from these aspirations and these intentions, but still, USA had come up with a policy of bilingual education. And then they gave option to many other populations who are in US regarding the bilingual option, and that has created a good impact. So as a matter of case study, we can refer to United States for these efforts, and we can also learn from these points. Now the last part of the presentation is challenges in implementation. So what are, these are all probable challenges. I'm not claiming that these are the only challenges. There might be challenges out of it, and there might be some challenges I may have missed or I may have exaggerated, which I don't feel or may not feel, but this is what my perception and my understanding about this particular problem. So first is utility of language. So when we talk about utility of language, and that's what precisely again we have to go back to a discussion, whether Sanskrit should be a language, one of the three languages, and should be taught in schools. So then the concern we have to raise is about this utility. Okay, language should be linked with employability. Do you agree? Whenever you are learning, you are forced to learn a new language, what you will ask? What is the use of it? What is the utility of it? And then a language should be linked with your employability. Simple example, if you learn German, your options of employability will increase. Yes? And that's why many people in year 11th and 12th, they go for German, they go for Spanish, or they go for French, rather than going to Sanskrit. Because we don't feel utility about it. Knowledge is fine, but the current situation of the students, focus should be on, or will be on, employability. So whether the language is going to create employability, that's what happens. Quality translations, that's another challenging field. As of now, we know that translations may mislead any literature to any other field. And that had happened with India. Most of Western literatures having liberal values had been translated into Marathi or had been translated into Hindi and in a different tone. Because we can use that kind of a power which is in the hands of translators. They can mislead, they can misguide you in that particular sense. So we need quality translations which are authentic, which are having some substance. And then as of now, we don't have any mechanism for it. We have a publication department at central level, state level, but how much they are working is another question. Okay, knowledge creation in regional or classical language. A language is not just a skill, okay, like MSCIT or if you learn computer, it's a skill base. But language is not just a skill, it's a way of expression, it's a way of your thought, it impacts your thought process. So that's why whenever we are telling that three languages we have to learn, so we should be able to create knowledge in those languages. Apart from translations, we have to create knowledge in those languages. So if you talk about Sanskrit, we need to create knowledge in Sanskrit. Then only people will feel utility about it, and then people will opt for it. Okay. So fortification of language departments in universities. As of now, from university which I come, it's a private university. So the private universities are focusing more on their day-to-day life for expenditure and based on profit, non-profit and the other dynamics, because we don't receive any grants from government. So we have to depend on the fees, tuition fees which we are collecting from students. So similarly, if we want to establish a language department, usually language departments are not, what we say, not preferred, and people don't pay much for learning language. If I say I offer a course in BA Marathi, how many of you will opt for? And then how much fees I can charge? If I can't charge much fees, I can't have that department in university. Public universities, we can expect that. Public universities do have. But again, they are in a very, sorry to say, but in a worrisome situation as of now. Because again, they don't have funds, they don't have faculties, they don't have any other resources to sustain. Few departments, few universities are doing good. But that's not a situation which will help us. If we want to implement bilingual education, multilingual education, we need to have language departments which are strong, who can help us in bringing new material, which can help us in bringing new literature. We cannot depend on only translations. And that's what we have to be focusing on, financial resources. So government should give grants to the people, those who are ready to translate, ready to bring material, bring research material, data in that particular language. And then another part is joy of learning. A very important aspect is that joy of learning. Whether learning a new language, if it is going to take away my joy of learning, then obviously it will be a challenge. That's why NEP, aapne ek point dekha hoga ki NEP talks about the languages should be taught in an impressive and inclusive way. So the pedagogies or the andragogies, whichever we are going to use, we should be using carefully, that it should not hamper the joy of learning. So language learning should be interesting. I should have that feel ki okay, kuch ek achha padhaya hai, kuch ek achha maine suna hai. And then there should be that kind of, there should not hamper your joy of learning, that's what I want to say. So all these are the points and pointers which I wanted to discuss with you all. If you have anything or any concerns, please let me know. Just see if I have, yeah, I think I have covered most of the points. Okay, one aspect is again another aspect I missed it. Concept of pure and standard language. Okay, so it's nowhere. I have seen few countries, I have visited few countries, I have worked with international organizations, and I have seen people who are not having a good command over English but having a good position at the international organizations, because they don't judge you on the basis of your competency in language as far as you are able to communicate. So that's what should matter. In Maharashtra and Marathi, we do have that kind of a sense ki zara bhashecha thode ikade tikade zale ki apan learn aani he sagya goshti apan, we focus more on that. That's kind of culture, part of culture. There's no wrong in that, like you should know grammar, you should know language properly, that's what. But if you don't know, it should not bar you from communicating. Most important aspect of language is to communicate. If you are able to communicate, that's fine. You know, no one is going to judge you on the basis of your grammar. And obviously we are not having English as a first language, we are not having, going to have French as a first language. But if you have, you are able to communicate, that's what, it's fine. So there is no pure language. There is no standard language. As I said, language is organic. How many of we are now able to speak in pure one language? We are coming up with English, we are coming up with English. Yeah, Marathi, Hindi, English. We use terminology, we use words. And I think in near future we have to think of that kind of language also. I mean, people are using, there are keyboards and students or the Gen Z are using that terminology. Yeah. So we have to think of that and we have to come up with those policies as well in near future. Okay, so combination of language. And that's a good thing. I don't see any wrong in that. Okay, so this was all from my side and I hope I have clarified few points. And open for questions or open for discussions if there are any. Okay, so I think I will stop here. Thank you again for calling me and listening me carefully.